Welcome to Bulletcast, the Bullet Catcher Gaming Podcast. In this pilot episode, we will be talking about the Ghost Recon Breakpoint Year 2 Roadmap. The guest for this episode will be Bacon Soldier, with your real name if you so choose.
It's Lee.
Tyrant.
Ed, what up?
Knuckles.
There's Knuckles here.
Tyrant Slayer.
Jeremy.
And I'm your voice host, 8UP, also named as Marcus. And your podcast host is Bullet Catcher, Andy. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for that, Marcus. Appreciate it. This is the Bullet Catcher Gaming Podcast. We'll probably do this once every couple of weeks. If you'd like to be a guest or jump in, join in on the podcast, the link is in the description of any of the videos, the description on this video, on any of the other ones you're looking at, you can find it on there. It's also on the link on the front of the channel. There are six of us on this one. Probably keep it to about that. But like I said, we do accept guests. We will be having some guests on from time to time as well, hopefully some other YouTubers as well. But yeah, so we're going to get underway. So year two, even though it's probably 18 months now since the game came out, this is year two, but we're going to wait till, I think it's June, until we're going to be getting the first actual update, which is AI teammates. So anyone got an opinion on AI teammates? What we're going to be getting?
Well, if I were to speculate, I'd say probably some individual controls. You can give commands to an individual teammate. Other than some AI updates, I really can't think of anything else they could do to enhance the teammate experience. I mean, obviously, the AI could use some work.
Hopefully, they'll make them less predictable.
In what way?
They tend to do the complete opposite of what you want them to do. They tend to...
Well, you ask them to move forward and they always run backwards.
Yeah, I mean, I was doing some recording a couple of weeks ago for a video that I've got, that I'd planned, and you'd send them off to go and just be static and don't move. And then you'd move and go and stand next to one of them, and they'd move off and go and do something completely opposite to what you want them to do. It's quite frustrating. So you don't want. So if you're trying to sort of scout a base, and you want them to just stay where they are, but you happen to go near where they're standing, they will then move in another direction or move off away from where you are, potentially giving away your position.
That is one thing.
Hopefully,
sorry to interrupt you, but that is one thing they're not good for. I mean, if you play this game because you like taking down bases, things like that, I think AI teammates, you just got to have them turned off.
Yeah,
can't utilize them for that. Really, yes, you can. They can. You can sit on the outside and sink shot, but you can't. You can't head into a base with them. They just give you away pretty much every time. I mean, if other people have had a different experience to that, then I'd love to hear of it. But that's my experience of it, and I know it's playing with other people too.
Well, they're not tactical wise, they're not. If you, I mean, I was bang on it about this game being tactical, and you know, like the hardcore players that want to be so tactical, sneaky beaky, for want of a better word. You can't use them as your teammates. You just can't, because they will give. You can't stack on a door and try and clear the room that you're going to go into, or go past that room that you want to. You know, you're clearing a building, for example. You can't do that with those AI teammates, because they'll go off and do their own thing, and it will completely screw up your tactics and everything else. So they need to be more. Well, Ubisoft needs to be aware that people want to use this game to be tactical, and they should be able to implement tactics. They need to look at proper tactics of military tactics, entering buildings, clearing buildings, clearing open areas, clearing compounds, that sort of stuff, or even like law enforcement. They need to be able, you know, they need to look at that sort of stuff and try and put that in. It's probably hard. It's probably really, really hard to try and put that into a game. But if they want to give people that realism, that immersion, then they need to try and work around that, because whenever I go to a base, I never bother having teammates because they'll always give you a position away. You can never clear a room properly with AI teammates. It's just not going to work. So you're better off just going to a facility and just clear it yourself.
I want to let some other people speak, but I just want to jump in and just comment on something you just said. Regards to, I'm sure it isn't the easiest thing to program, but the problem that I have with that is that other games, previous games from 10 or 15 years ago, have already done this. And Ubisoft themselves have already done this. I mean, anyone who's played Rainbow Six Vegas, the way that you could entry, door entry with your teammates was far superior than how you can currently do it. I mean, why can't they use that type of system? There's no reason why we can't have that in the game. I mean, I still personally, for me, still put SOCOM as a benchmark game for how to have a game with your teammates.
SOCOM was a good game.
First of all, I think if you're having teammates, you need to care about them. And I know that might sound a bit ridiculous because people say it's a game, but games have moved on from what they were. You can care about characters in games. And for me, if you have teammates, personally, what I'd like to see is the kind of fear factor that they can die. If they're injured or wounded and they're down on the ground, and they should be able to die, and you should be able to revive them and get them back up. With the fear in SOCOM, it was terrifying if you thought one of your teammates was going to die, because that's it. They're gone. They're not coming back. You don't get to the next checkpoint, and then they reappear again. They were dead. Mm. And I think that adds a next level of immersion, which I think I can't see that being added into Breakpoint, though I would love it to be. But the next game, at the very least. Anyway, what else do you guys think about the AI teammates? Is there anything else you think we might be getting within it?
Well, now that you mentioned Vegas, along that lines, I'd like to see contextual commands based on what you're looking at. Like in Vegas, you look at the door and you could say stack up, or you look at the crack on like the floor underneath the door and you could say snake cam the door. I think that would be far more effective than the hitting the wheel and then taking the little finger and moving around to where you want them to go. The whole experience is just kind of clunky for me. I don't use AI teammates. I used them for about 3 hours total and I shut them back off. To that point too, what you were saying, Andy, having your teammates be dead, I would love to see that too, because I'd probably just turn around and shoot them myself.
I think being able to give voice commands rather than, like you say, like the command wheel. We're using headsets and microphones for crying out loud, so why can't we use those within the game? Like we used to be able to with SOCOM. So you can press a button and go, right, stack on me. And then you've got your teammates behind you, and you can give that command. Really well. And then, why can't they implement it in Breakpoints?
I think that's actually in the works. Microsoft just acquired a company, the company that makes Dragon Naturally Speaking. All they do is voice recognition and voice synthesis. So I imagine that's probably going to be becoming in the DirectX API that Xbox and Windows uses.
I'd like them to be able to see sending AI teammates individually to different locations instead of all of them going at once.
Yeah.
That's key.
To introduce call sign intervention, state your name.
Name is Samuel T. Hyma, and a thing I would really like to see AI teammates update is their specialization dying in a fight. And what I mean about that is Yuri is clearly all about close quarter combat. Her primary weapon is the Vector in the lore. She's a CQC specialist. She knows how to use a knife. Let us see her doing what she's good at. Vasily is a sniper. His primary rifle is the Scorpio. I don't know if it's a variant of what rifle, but that's what they call it. Let us see him at range doing what he's good at. Fix its primary weapon, the compact. Let us see him being a support gunner. Nomad's primary assault rifle is a 5.62 Goblin based. Ask. Let us see us when we give them the weapon systems they're proficient in, just utterly destroying. That is what I want. Let their proficiency really shine, because if they're on the same tier as Nomad, Holt, Midas, Weaver, Walker, any members of Ghost Recon, the rifle and weapon system they know well, they should know exceptionally well. Miles above Sentinel, and maybe on par with the Wolves. The point is, they should be far more effective if you're having run them run, let alone the weapon systems or their signature weapons, which you currently get all of them, except for the Goblin. So for Nomad, I'd say if they add this AI teammates update, which they might not, make Nomad as effective with the 5.16 as he is in the Goblin when you're playing as him in the game. That is what I would like.
What do you? It would also be quite nice. It would be quite nice as well if they actually gave some of your AI teammates a little bit of backstory.
Mm-hmm.
Because there is, you know, they just appeared with a click of a button. It would have been nice if we could have at least. I really did think when they were introduced that we had a mission where you came across them and found them. I was a little bit disappointed that we didn't have that.
I honestly really want a mission where we find out what happened to their former Ghostly, because what I've heard the lore is that Fixit, Vasily, and Fury's Ghostly is either MIA or dead, like their former team. They were a squad already. And then they met Nomad Adair 1 after their team had either been captured or died. I think that mission story based around that would be pretty cool. Or maybe even we're playing as one of the three of them, and the AI teammates is the head of the squad and the other two. And we actually play through seeing him die, unlike we sadly could not with the intro of the game. This is about year two. I'm not going to talk about the death of Weaver. I talked about it. I think that could be. Actually, you know, they crash land, their Ghost City is like, hey guys, we're going to go over. You're playing as either Fury, Vasily, or Fixit. You still have the sync shot commands. Maybe this is how you unlock one of their special skills. I don't know. I think this would be really fun to explore. What happened to that Ghost member?
I did a video on AI teammates when they first came out. And in that video, I tested the AI teammates versus every difficulty. And what I found is that the AI teammates worked way better on the harder settings than they did on the lower settings. Now, that makes no sense at all. Okay? So if you put it on, what is the lowest setting? I can't remember. Is it just, it's not easy. What's it called?
I think it's like Recruit.
Recruit, yeah.
Yeah, it's
Recruit. On Recruit, they were murdered, and I did the same scenario four different times, and they failed, and they were terrible, and they just got their asses kicked. But as I moved up, each time they seemed to improve. And so what I will say is, if anyone, I don't know, you know, different people play for different reasons, and some people might like playing on Recruit, and that's fine. There's no judgment on anybody. You should be able to play the game however you want. But I would say that if you are using AI teammates on Recruit, try them on Elite, because even though the game's going to be harder for you, for some unknown reason, they seem to be way better on Elite. I cleared the same compound way easier on Elite than I did when I tested it on Recruit, which is kind of crazy, because they should have been seen easier and killed easier, but they weren't. It's really weird. I don't quite get what happened there. But just moving on from the actual AI teammates themselves and what we think we might get. I mean, we talked about individual commands. We mentioned about the fact that being able to choose how many you take with you, for example, that you just take one with you instead of three or whatever. Do you think that we're going to get... Because they did turn around and say that within these updates, we are going to be getting some requested features. Do you think that we will get requested features within this AI teammates update? And what do you think they might be?
I'm going to hold my peace till everyone else goes. That's all I was going to say while I was unmuted.
Oh. Pardon me.
Okay.
I'd like to see teammates that fill in to fill out the squad when you have less than four people on your team in multiplayer.
So when you're playing just like you and one friend, you can fill up the rest of your team with two teammates.
Yep, bring two of them in, and then the team lead is the one that gives them commands.
That'd be cool.
Really, the team lead has no real role right now other than, coming out of Bivouac. So it's only advantage to being a team leader. But I think if you were a team leader and you brought in, two teammates to fill those two empty slots in your multiplayer game, then as team lead, you're the one that gives the commands. Do you either maybe they could use the follow me mechanic, where you look at your teammate and say follow me, just like you do with some of the NPCs, and then they would just follow you, and you would assume command of that person or persons for the time that you had them.
Or like Conflict Desert Storm, where you had you and three AI teammates, and you could control any of them. You just jump between, they weren't really AI teammates, you just jump between any of those characters, place them all exactly where you want them. That would be cool. I'd like that.
That would work well. But Conflict Desert Storm also wasn't kind of as generic as this one is. Every AI teammate can rock a weapon that you rock, whereas in Conflict Desert Storm, where that was the case, they each specialized in a certain role. And like what call sign said, they don't do that in this one. Personally, I'd like to see them get a little bit more literal with the receiving of instructions or orders. I'd like to see them be a little bit smarter. If I tell somebody to hold position, they're not going to hold position, as Bacon said. They're going to wander around doing whatever fucking the hell they want. If I tell them to go somewhere, I play with AI teammates. I have to suffer through that. And I've done some experimenting on my own. But as soon as I tell them to go somewhere else, they don't stay there. As soon as I start moving on, they start following suit. And it's not go there and then stay there. I can't tell them to go there and hold position, because then they'll just continue wandering aimlessly around. The most that I've ever had them go was whenever I tell them to open fire, and they'll run through the fucking base. And last time I did it recently, they got fucking killed. But
they have the command wheel of hold position or go to that position, but they don't do it.
Well, Ghost Recon 2 had I don't want to say it was the best one. If they could take what Ghost Recon 2 had, and it was smart, you could tell somebody to go either looking through your map to a certain location, or by looking at the location and telling them to move, you could tell them to flank left, flank right, open fire, hold position. And you always had a battle buddy. Two people went off, it was a four-man team, two people went off to where you ordered, and then you always had one other stick with you. So if you told them to flank left, two would go left, you could go right, and you had somebody there to back you up as well. Same thing if you told them to hold position. You were never solo.
So I think with the drone as well, you could take it a step further. They could. Not only could you individually have them placed in different locations, you can choose via the sync shot to the drone and select different targets for the individual teammate number to shoot, and then command it on there through the drone or through your interface. Okay, this AI teammate, shoot this guy of his number, because he's assigned to that number, right?
Just quick question before you answer that. Or does someone want to answer that first? Someone answer that one first, because I can't remember.
I don't like it because it's overpowered. I don't like having the sync shot mechanic, because they will plow right through buildings, hills, rocks, whatever, to get their target. Doesn't matter if they have line of sight or not. Apparently, they're rocking all HUD, and you're sitting there going like, all right, shoot this guy. They're fucking out on a hill behind a boulder, shooting through a three-story, a single story, and then the guy's head. Damn the windows. We're going through the brick and concrete and advanced metal that they're fucking using.
Did anyone notice, though, that on Wildlands, when you were using the sync shot, did you ever have one of those scenarios, if you were trying to snipe from quite a far distance away, that you would set your team up and you'd be like, you'd see the three guys that you wanted them to take out, and you'd be like, right, one, two, three, you'd mark them up, and then one of them or two of them would forever just be crossing each other You'd see them in front of you crossing over, and they'd be like, "Oh, lost him. Oh, no, got him again."
Yeah. I want to bring up.
Jesus Christ, come on. I should have just done it myself.
Something that I want to bring up about that as well is make it... I don't know how to explain this other than an example. Like in Wildlands, same thing happens in Breakpoint. You have a sync shot marker. Go through whatever the fucking hell they want. You can have a sync shot marker from two clicks fucking out, and a guy with a submachine gun will make that shot just as well as that guy with that 50 cal.
Yeah, I know.
From where he could be right next to you and fucking make that shot.
Yeah, that is ridiculous. Mm-hmm. That is totally ridiculous. Anyway. Let's move it on a little bit. So a bit of AI teammate discussion there. So what about the actual update itself for AI teammates? What else do you think we'll get with it? Now, I made a video recently, I believe maybe, and it might not come in the AI teammates, it might come in the year two thing, but I'm going to include it in this. I still think that we might get the optical camo. Though that might be in the event in the fall, which we'll talk about later. They've given it away, basically, that we're finally getting ghillie hoods. And if we're getting ghillie hoods, I would also imagine that we're going to get the ability to wear a mask with a tactical helmet.
Please, God. I think I want to say something there, Andy. That picture was only with the Cry Combat G3 shirt, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like the ghillie, so what I think they did was they only made the ghillie hood for that shirt and nothing else.
I think that'd be the only
I think that's what's happening. I think that's what happened.
It sounds so like
it was the ghillie hood, but only for one color, which is multicam.
Yeah, so we may not get masks with helmets. That will disappoint a lot of people.
We're just getting a hood.
Because it's so annoying when you're trying to create your character. And you put a mask on, you know, like you should be able to wear a gas mask with a helmet.
Mm-hmm. You can't allow that.
That you can't do.
Hey,
that.
Man, that spandex is way too fucking thick, man. That latex it may be skin tight, but you know that's just unacceptable. That's structurally unsound for your helmet. It just attracts bullets.
Do you think we'll get any other features added? What other features may we get? Do you think?
I think we might be able to get the option to fully kit out what our AI teammates are running. Not going on AI mechanic, just overall kit. People have been asking for the ability to turn off the second weapon on their kit and such like that.
In their inventory?
In their inventory. So maybe being able to turn off to where they have only one weapon, just like you. Should you choose so.
What about them having secondary items as well?
Like grenades, flashbangs.
Do you think that could happen?
I've
been saying this for a long time, doing the loadout videos. When you look at any vest or loadout these guys are wearing when they're out in the field, they don't just have a plate cover and a couple of mags around the front, or a mag to the side, or some wanky water bottle around the back. They're fully loaded. They've got fucking kit hanging off of every single thing possible. You know, they've got mole vests, you name it, with shotgun shells, grenades, flashbangs, you name it. They've got stuff everywhere. Now, the loadouts that we get for all these different types of vests, they're all the same. They'll have four mags at the front, maybe two mags around the side, and that is it. It's too bare. They don't look realistic. It's very clinical in the way that the vests just look. You can't customize. Well, I'll put a couple of grenades on the shoulder of the yokes on the vest, or a couple of flashbangs around the back, around the side.
Well, effectively,
yeah, it's just too.
Utilize the mole vest for how it's supposed to be used.
Well, this is what I'm saying. Like, the mole vests are there for to put shit on, not just to have a couple of mags or a couple of pouches. You should be able to put stuff all over the place, you know. And you just don't get. It's all very well in your your weapons reel, where you look up where you've got an EMP grenade, a couple of hand grenades, you know, a flashbang. You can't actually see those on your vest when you play the game. You just randomly put your hand around the back and, oh, there you go.
Yep.
You got a nice hole in your backpack there. It's easy to pull shit out. Exactly what you want out, including that rocket launcher.
Yeah, where is that rocket launcher coming from?
Exactly. Your ass out of his ass. Exactly. So if you choose to have a rocket launcher, like a 66 or the law anti-tank weapon,
It should be there.
It should show there. You know what I mean? So if you swap round,
the rocket launcher goes,
and then the hand grenade appears. So if you want a hand grenade, then the hand grenade will appear on your vest. You know, you see what I mean? It just it's not customizable enough.
Because they've set the number of grenades that you can have to very few. So it makes sense. If you say you're carrying
three,
then... Well, I suppose, yeah, if you're picking, there is a lot that you can add to the weapon wheel since the update. And I suppose you can pick different mark versions of the grenade. So I suppose that would be a lot of grenades on your vest. But they could change that. They didn't have to add all of those on there. So it could have been that if they only allowed you to have three grenades, you'd see all three grenades on your vest. When you threw one, you'd only have two. You know, it would be kind of cool to see that. That makes total sense.
Well, I mean, the easiest way to do that is actually have grenade pouches. You'll still have three grenade pouches, even though you only have one grenade.
Exactly.
But, I mean, look, for example, like, and this might sound stupid, Arnie in Commando, how much shit does he carry in that film at the end? Loads of shit.
He was taking on bad guys that were the barracks were made of balsa wood.
The bad guy was a very camp Australian. But why can't we load out our character with what we choose that he's got? You know what I mean? Like the vest. This is what frustrates me when like people have a moan that it don't look realistic enough on the loadouts that we do. It's because we can't customize them to what I look at a picture and I go, right, that's what I'm going to do my loadout on, but I can't make it 100% accurate because Ubisoft don't give us the tools to go, right, they put a grenade there, flashbang there, loads of other gubbins there, you know, handcuffs there, or whatever the fuck he might be carrying.
90% of the people listening to this are like, what the fuck is a gubbins?
It's a paper monkey, isn't it?
No. So bacon.
Stuff.
Hey, so bacon.
Go on, mate.
What, you got a monkey in your pouch?
I think they could carry on with it, too, going into the backpack, like, the size or the type of backpack you're using will depend on how many items of that you could also carry.
Yes.
Yeah. I think the biggest...
That's a good point, but...
Pretty.
When you're in a combat situation, you're not going to go, right, hang on, I've got to get my rucksack off or my backpack off and get my grenade out.
No, you have a teammate that does it for you. He uses what's on your person for you, and then you use what's on his person for him.
See, that's just not real. I mean, if people want to, but I see what you're saying, but people.
Like, let's say if you want to apply a tourniquet, you take the tourniquet off the person that's bleeding out and you use their tourniquet. You don't use yours because that's for you. That's what I'm saying. See, like, if you're taking off from like a backpack.
Yeah, but IFACs are a whole different set of rules.
Yeah.
Backpacks are there for your spare clothes, your first aid kit, your water, your spare rations and all that sort of stuff. If we want to be real immersive.
Oh, first aid kit can go on a molly pouch. You can have a molly pouch.
You're right. But you can also have a personal first aid kit inside your Bergen. So you can have your spare clothes, your meals, all that sort of, your spare water, you name it, all in that backpack. Rather than your weapons.
instead of equipment, you could probably just limit it to food or rations. Like how many of rations you have on you for the backpack.
See, I mean, you can opt out to not have a backpack, can't you?
Yeah.
So, I mean, what I'm talking about is the realism of the loadout of your vest. Because all of them, it doesn't matter what vest you go through, they are all not adequate enough.
But there's some you can't even change colours on.
No, you're right. You're absolutely right. But they're not adequate enough for realism. I mean, like, you look at, like, some of the SAS guys, Spetsnaz and the SEALs, they're carrying fucking loads of stuff. But when you see it on, when you do a loadout on Breakpoint, it's just like, oh, yeah, I'm rocking a couple of mags and a little vest.
Well, not only that, the mags don't change with your weapon.
Yeah, it's just like a crop top. I'm wearing a crop top vest.
Yeah, the mags, The mags
they
do
don't look.
No, they don't. Your stag mags. Your stag mags will work with 5.16.
No, you switch over to Nestle Machine, they'll become 9mm.
Yeah, I know, but okay. That's not what Knuckles was saying. What Knuckles was saying was. No.
It doesn't matter to me. It doesn't matter what loadout you use on this game. Nomad does not look hard enough. Doesn't look like he can eat nail sandwiches. He just really doesn't.
I don't know. Have you not seen some of the weird shit that he eats in the bivouac?
The
donkey's balls or whatever it is that he eats.
Yep.
I don't know what they are.
Well, I mean, if we're going to go on the subject of Nomad, it's not like he's been through the two hardest special forces training in the USA.
Okay, bud.
Just saying about that.
Clear your throat, mate.
My point being is that I agree. Should look a lot more. I'm not saying go to like Arnold Schwarzenegger levels in Commando because that movie was fun, but
no.
It's not realistic. Though.
Yeah.
Wait, but, this movie?
Really?
It's a documentary.
I thought it was.
Carrying three primaries and all that shit. No, it is not. And don't even get me started about the Uzi on his hip and the RPK just
come on. You
over
wouldn't.
His shoulder
no way that you would turn down throwing knives though, like he does in that.
No,
film.
No.
Throwing knives. Come on.
It's the saw blades that he fucking chops the top of that geezer's head off.
I mean, honestly, look, we have termination guns. Is it really that surprising that they would do that?
No. I agree, Knuckles. I'm what I'm trying to say is that I agree. Our characters should look a lot more intimidating. Like, for example, what Andy says a lot. When you think of a special forces person, either a movie, a book, or any form of media, they're dressed in all black. They've got the coolest shit, and they look scary.
And they're supposed to look scary. That's the part of
because you don't want to fight them because they'll kill you.
They're supposed to look scary. Some of the gear.
I don't think they're supposed to look scary.
I've read hundreds of special forces books. That is definitely when they are designing some of this gear. It is 100% definitely put into it about the fact that they want these people to look.
There's definitely an intimidation factor there.
So when the enemy sees you, you look almost slightly inhuman. It automatically puts you on the back foot, and you haven't even fired a shot at this point. That's what it's a lot of that is supposed to be.
Exactly,
intimidation factor, 100%. Along with the violence of action. That, you know, about what we're talking about earlier about in this game about being able to breach, fast breach, clear all this stuff. It's that along with the look. It's all part and parcel of the whole package of what these guys do. And that
well,
is
look at the action. That's a bit different, though, isn't it?
It's all part of it, though. It's all part of what
the psychological warfare definitely pays.
Yeah, and it's the thing. It's the same with law enforcement as well. with law enforcement, when they're making
SWAT guy, you know they don't fuck
around. Over here, we've got ARVs, which are the armed response vehicles, and then we've got the counter-terrorism specialist firearms officers. They look like the SAS.
Yes, LEO,
and they train with the SAS.
The perfect example.
Now, the guys that we're going up against,
they could put any of these guys in really basic gear. It could still be advanced, but it could look really basic. You know, it doesn't have to look like it does, but they make it look that way for a reason. Anyway, we're getting completely off topic here.
Let's move.
If anyone's got any final thoughts on the AI teammate update, if not, we're going to move on to the Tomb Raider update.
Go
for it.
I want your guys' thoughts on this one. Do you think they will get the class abilities which their characters represent? Facility, AP rounds, Fix-It and the drone, and Fury with the cloak and run.
I don't think they'll do that at all.
Yeah, I don't think they'll do that either. How would you even trigger that? Because the AP rounds are your special ability. So you would have to be able to trigger the special ability for them.
Ash, Thatcher, and Finn could do it. It would be based on the situation.
Yeah, but each of those had a certain trigger. How would you trigger it? Like, okay, hey, you have an AP round that can go through a Jug's helmet.
For Furies, it would be if you are fully detected. Obviously, that would be the trigger.
But if you want to be fully detected, now you have an automatic ability that just got used.
Yeah.
Okay, either fully detected or you're fighting a swarm of drones there. Because of hiding from those two.
Maybe you go down?
That could work too.
I don't think it's overly feasible with the input methods.
So
yeah.
For the Fix-It special ability, I would say just the drone comes out when shit's really hitting the fan. Like, you're completely surrounded. They've called in, assuming they add reinforcement waves back from Wildlands, be on the second or third wave. And, I would agree with the question Tyrant had for the AP rounds. If you either target a heavy with a sync shot or maybe a lightly armored vehicle, and they actually implement where anti-material rounds will fuck a car in one shot.
Maybe. So, let's say you'd use a sync shot on a heavy. If you use a sync shot on a heavy, the AI teammates will have to know which of the AI teammates will be shooting the heavy. If you use an LMG, LMG doesn't have the sniper class. Why is he using AP rounds and not the guy using the TAC or the HDI or whatever else he's using? They're going to have to write that, and I don't think that's going to happen.
Jenny, I think ability shouldn't be the right word. If you give add more go along with lines of equipment.
Yeah.
Let's take Ash for example. She has a grenade launcher that she uses to target drones. Turrets, ground drones. I don't know if she targets flying drones. I think that one might be a bit of a stretch. But if you give, say Fix-It or Fury or hell, even Vasily, a fucking rocket launcher, they look at vehicles, they look at turrets, they look at ground drones. And as soon as shit gets loud, if they see one with clear line of sight, they pop that bitch out and they fucking nail it.
Then my question would be, since Ubisoft said they're getting abilities, what do you think they will get in place of their class ability?
I have no idea. And I honestly don't know if I want to know. I honestly don't know if be cut from the Siege 3.
But there's the cooldown factor too. I mean, you can track cooldown factors for each one of these characters.
Yep, probably.
I
would assume there's cooldown because there is for the R6 ones.
See, what would make that a little bit more interesting is if you went with the equipment idea and using the rocket launcher as an example, you buy rocket rounds and you can distribute, just like with people in your game. Somebody's short on something, they ain't got the materials, you can craft it, you can share it with them in a bivouac, right? Do that with an AI. Now you have an inventory. Now you have a limited number of rounds. So as soon as they run out, they run out. If you want to add a cooldown onto that, I don't know.
So those three AP rounds will be expended.
Because in the RTC Fix-It, use the drone, and I don't know if that's meant to be the recon drone or the engineer own ability. I brought it up.
I don't want him to use a drone. I honestly don't. I didn't like that drone whenever I used it. The last thing I want is an AI to use it.
I'd like them to bring back some of the drones from Wildlands, though. I love the explosive drone from Wildlands.
Yes, I was taking a second for what you meant. Yes, that was fun.
That was my cool. Vote on anyway, that right. AI teammates. We're done on AI teammates. Right? We're going to move on.
Not yet. I have one more thing.
Go for it.
It's about the kit. It's not about the mechanic. Bit. I've handed a couple of guys M4s, assault rifles, whatever's with 203s. Like to see them use that.
Actually use grenade launchers, yeah.
Yeah, I agree.
Or the underbarrel shoddy, if a mission takes place in one of those small breach and clear rooms. You know the ones introduced in the R6 event, guys? If, like,
I don't know if I'm going to handle a shotgun. I don't know if I want to have them handle a shotgun. I'd be scared of that.
No, I meant the underbarrel on the assault rifle attachment. That one, the master key with 5-shot.
Again, if you're expecting them to know when to use it.
Yeah.
That's true.
And that's kind of where the fault on my end is.
Have AI teammates and you have friendly fire on. They'd probably kill
you. Yeah, I was about to say that. I actually kind of want to see friendly fire. I really kind of do wish to see the AI have friendly fire.
So
if people want to sit there and talk about realism, let's go full out.
Yeah. Well, if they're going to do that, they also need to bring back the lassoing of lasers, because then you can see if you're being flagged or not by your teammates, and then they're going to kill you.
Anyway, the second part of this year's update, Tomb Raider event.
Oh, God.
What do we think? I said right from the get-go that I believed that it was never going to be a crossover event. It was just going to be a small thing, and I believed it was going to be a treasure hunt, and they've pretty much confirmed that it is a treasure hunt. I don't think that you are going to meet her. I don't think she's going to be on the island. I don't think you're going to talk to her face-to-face. I think you're either going to talk to her on a radio or find a message of hers or something like that. And then they will utilize some of the ancient ruins, because there's so many ancient ruins that have not been used for anything. Some of them haven't even got enemies at them. There's nothing there, really. But they're interesting locations nonetheless. And I think you'll go from one to the other to the other. I don't know whether you'll necessarily do clues and puzzles and things. I mean, they might do that, but I think overall it will be something along the lines of you find this, then go there, and then go there, and it will be a fun little kind of thing. And at the end of it, you'll get a reward of probably a bow. I think most people, are we all agreement that we're everyone in agreement?
Yeah. I don't think we'll get a bow.
I would say either a bow or the ability to repel, but it's going to be one of those.
That'll
be a huge update, massive update.
Can I answer that statement with a question?
Go for it.
Don't we have a fucking island to liberate?
Yeah, right?
Yeah. We do.
Why are we focusing on this?
I could see crossbow, now the full size recurve bow. Think about how the crossbow would make much more sense as far as a development time and development resources goes. The way you would hold and shoot the crossbow is almost identical to how you would hold and shoot a rifle. If you go with a bow, you're not only going to have to create the bow assets, but you're also going to have to motion capture all the new movements with the bow as well. Because all the animations are done with motion capture. I just don't see them doing that in this late in the game.
They can't even get motion capture for reloading properly.
Yeah.
I also see them doing a crossbow because exactly that, the reload, you're going to have to fucking animate that reload.
Right, but it'll be
minimal. It's going to be some jank AR reload.
It'll be minimal. I don't even think we're going to get a weapon. Minimal. I think we're going to get a trinket.
Trinket? Honestly, if we're going to get a weapon, I'm betting it's going to be a pistol.
It could be a revolver or something. It's definitely not.
No, I'm not going to sit there and say it's going to be the akimbo, but it can be one of her pistols.
Yeah.
I forgot.
Yeah,
I was on her custom.
I reckon we'll get a ponytail.
Oh my god. For the female characters?
Maybe we'll get a butler to follow us around to narrow one.
Oh, I'd be okay. Yeah. I wouldn't mind that. Hey, Jeeves, another
We're going to get that
game at all.
He's going to link in with the AI teammates, all three.
I think it's going to be a circle for the knife.
We're going to get that ponytail instead of that braid.
Honestly, I think it's just going to be collectibles.
I think it will be too.
I mean, they are making a deal out of the fact that she's left something behind. I mean, I really do think it's going to be a weapon. If it's not the crossbow, then I think one of her pistols.
Well, maybe we might get dual pistols.
Maybe. Oh, no, I hope not.
It's not going to be a Kembo. It's not going to be the Kembo pistol.
It would be terror. It wouldn't work. Why would you want that in this game? I mean, some people might admit.
Why would you want Terminator in this game? I mean, why did they do anything?
Knuckles, I'm gonna ignore that question and try to respect you after saying it.
Think about it. Like, this is a Delta squad coming to an island to see what's going on. Why the hell are some futuristic robots here? Really?
Well, you have the background setting for it.
To ask yourself about that question, let's ask why the behemoths are here.
No, I think it's a valid question.
Mechanical tanks, like...
Skynet's been established. Skynet's been established, and Skynet has no connection to Skelltech, so... I want to hear this. Yeah, I want to hear this. Tell me how I'm wrong.
In the event, the lady actually does, there is an insinuation, it's not directly stated, that Nomad makes, that my guess is some kind of way to intertwine the Terminator games and the Ghost Recon setting for fuck no what reason. The insinuation that she makes, or that Nomad makes to her, that really she doesn't argue with, is let's keep this under wraps. I don't want Skelltech getting ideas about fucking cyborgs. So I hope this isn't where they're going with this, but I wouldn't be surprised in the next game if we get a Terminator event. It's more like the Borg from Star Trek. I hope it's not, but I
would
be surprised.
Absolutely surprised if we get another Terminator event. That was a failed movie. Had a launch in a failed game. I don't think they're going to do that again.
No chance, especially after the movies absolutely.
Oh,
hard as it did as well.
The only good Terminator movies are the first two.
Okay, well, anyway, I don't think we're here to debate quality of movies.
not on the first one, anyway.
I was just speaking to the connection between drones and the Terminators, because I don't think
I actually think this is a really good conversation to have on another podcast about what crossovers could work in a future game, because I do think that's actually a valid a discussion, but we won't have that now. Oh,
yes,
we have done a video about
facing up against Cobra Commander. Come on, let's do it.
Cobra! You've been managing the fucking Sentinel.
You guys could hear that G.I. Joe comment? G.I. Joe.
To be fair, it would work in a way that, you know, that Cobra at least is a terrorist organization and Delta would go up against terrorists, not big, giant robotic tanks on Apple Island.
I like how we went from fighting cartel people in caves to, all right, we're going to be fighting giant robotic machines that can shoot gas launchers.
On Apple Island. Hey, that's
anyway,
pretty good.
He
one.
Said
I
we
like
weren't
that.
Doing the crossover talk now, so let's not. This is a whole other podcast.
Yeah.
So
all right, let's move on.
Let's move track.
On. Let's move on to the big one.
The big one.
In full, we are going to be receiving this new event that we now know is called Operation Motherland. And what do you guys believe that we will see in this event? Do you think, these are the main points I think we need to cover. Do you think we will actually get some kind of ending of the story? Or because obviously points have kind of been, let's be honest, forgotten. Do you think we'll get anything more to do with Wonderland? We're still missing a Wonderland clue. What do you think that we're going to get from this? Do you think it's going to be mission-based, non-mission-based? We've had lots of people on the YouTube comments talking about they want it to be a ghost mode. What do you think it's going to be? And how do you think it's going to work?
Well, I definitely don't think it's going to be a ghost mode. This game's in no condition to have a ghost mode.
I wouldn't mind having some sort of ghost mode, but a lot of things have to be tweaked. I don't think we're going to see it.
It's going to have to be a checklist, 1,000 items long of bugs to fix before they can even think about doing a ghost mode.
What I think is, I've made this no secret. You all heard my opinion.
Oh, here we go.
Have we?
I know you guys don't. I know that there are other options this could be, but out of the most fitting. I think
Bodok, you know, it's the most fitting
as the main villain and well, not main villain, but at least a main antagonist or group. And I honestly wouldn't mind this if they kind of functioned like how Unidad did with Santa Blanca back in Wildlands, in terms of, let's say, for example, you walk up to a random patrol of Sentinel and Bodark characters who just interject with each other on their patrol path. If you shoot a member of the Sentinel Patrol, due to the unshake relationship with Bodark, which some of the in-game dialogue actually during the event, or during episode 3, if you listen to it, the Sentinel employees actually fucking hate Bodark, apparently. Though them getting into a gunfight, I wouldn't mind seeing a return of that mechanic, because I'll tell you right now, in Free Roam, I did not have more fun than watching Unidad and Santa Blanca duke it out because I dropped some random gangbanger. It was hilarious. So that's what I would like to see if Bodark returns as a full-scale antagonistic team.
In this event in full, would anyone like to see if they add more kind of updates or add a different thing? Let's say they bring in a new faction. Let's say it's Bodark, or let's say it's some new faction, whatever it is, as part of this story, because Operation Motherland doesn't exactly sound like Sentinel. Definitely sounds like something else coming into this.
Like Russian or Serbian.
Yeah, exactly. If they brought in another force, would you like to see that force operate in the same way as like Unidad do in Wildlands? With like the more that you kill, the more that you attack, then the more
if it's
they
the Russian, if it's the Russian Federation, oh my God, that's a lot happening at once. Like, so I think they would have to choose something similar.
You know,
like, I really don't think it's going to be the Russian Federation. Just on principle, this is still... technically, it's a private island, but it used to belong to the U.S. U.S. Right. is going to want sovereignty over that island again. If Russian makes an advance on it, you're damn right Congress is going to get pissed on it.
And it might lead to war.
Well, you never know, because, like, in this game lore, Congress hasn't done shit, so...
Oh, don't... Right. Let's not get started about U.S. Congress and fucking breakpoint setting. Christ.
Right. Keep going, then.
Oh, yeah.
Going.
I think Blue Waffles turned up.
No, shut up.
I refuse to believe that any fucking government would fuck up this hard when they have this much evidence for this long. And allow me to elaborate on what I mean. CIA, Team Rainbow, and Ghost Recon all have had direct contact with Nomad and his team on this island.
CIA have had contact with Nomad?
Sam Fisher, he still works for them.
No. Sam Fisher does not work with the CIA. He is handled. I think that's basically it. He has a handler from the CIA. I don't think he's part of the CIA.
I thought it was a game that was like a full-on joint operation.
So he's standing out in the CIA.
Echelon is a separate.
Okay. The point is, Echelon, Ghost Recon, and Team Rainbow all have had direct contact with him. And I don't know much about Mitchell, but I think he'd have enough pull to at least get some shit moving in the White House.
Oh.
I don't
think I may never have that much pull.
No, they don't.
No.
Do you think that we are actually going to get, obviously, do you think we're going to get an ending, and how do you think that they are going to implement Bowman into the story of it?
He'll be the connection that actually gets it fucking moving along and actually gets Nomad some goddamn help aside from the outcasts.
Oh, sweet Jesus Christ. Enough of the reinforcements. If they haven't come yet, they ain't coming at all.
Yeah.
Do you think there won't be like some end scene where the...
It's been 18 months and no fuckers turned up.
Yeah, the aircraft carrier is actually going to do... It's an aircraft carrier, isn't
it? Yeah, it's an aircraft. Well, it's aircraft striker group.
Yeah,
because so, they want to just send one lone carrier. That's retarded.
Do you think that we will actually get them in some kind of end credit sequence or something?
No, I hope so.
I think we'll get them in the end credit.
Getting onto this goddamn island.
Yeah, I think we'll get them in the cut.
Isn't the actual story that the guy who's the mole is on that ship?
No.
Wasn't it? I thought he was.
Are you talking about Miles? Yeah, that confused me too.
Miles is not on the ship. Miles was a congressman, and he was fucking arrested.
And yeah, as I say, even then in episode 3, literally they did drop he's been dealt with also.
So if Walker's dead, we've dealt with most everything. There's nothing left to do here.
Walker's dead, Stone's dead, Miles is in prison.
But we need to take back the whole lot. We need to take back the island from the...
Well, like, from, you know, everyone who's played the game has done every mission at this point, or has done by now, or is going to complete it soon, if they haven't.
Well,
but for the people who've had this game for years so far, we've done everything in every base, every checkpoint, every compound there is to do. So in terms of the game, completion-wise, everyone should be dead. No one should be respawning, no one should be there, because it's done.
Yeah. Except for the fact that we've heard that Sentinel is bringing guys onto the island, and
we never going through
here.
Yeah.
No, we never see it. But
the other thing is, you don't have to retake the island to retask Nomad somewhere else that's more important.
That's true.
He's not dedicated to that island. It's just where he's at for this assignment.
Yeah.
He could get reassigned. And it wouldn't surprise me at all to see Bowman come back in and say, look, you know, Nomad and his team did a great job in Bolivia, and, you know, this is the only person that I want for this high priority op. And they pull him out.
And maybe it takes place on Moa Island. Again, doubtful, but...
Oh, my God.
Moa Island is not going to happen.
That's never going
to
happen.
Moa Island is definitely out of the equation.
I mean, it would be something to see just to point...
Hey, he's away!
Who dat? Who dat?
We all called you in a while ago, and you did
drawn up and blown away.
I mean,
you got some blue waffles there.
And I guess my question for you guys would be: if not Moa, if this is a new map, where will Nomad be going? Because I honestly have no idea.
I would first like to see how they were going to get him off the island. I mean, true enough, yes, the drone swarm is what taken out. So where are the
It's still active, apparently. Another thing about that one,
it's active and self-aware.
It becomes self-aware. Why is it still holding the island hostage? What motive does
A quadrant has been self-aware. They only took out one sector. They didn't take out the rest.
Gotcha.
So make Motherland a mission of taking out all the other quadrants so we can get some reinforcements in or get off the island.
If we also have something like a strike designator, why can't we use that as well on the mission for taking out certain software systems? Unless it's underground.
How is the strike designator being brought in anyway? I mean, you got a missile flying in. Where is it flying in from?
Right. Some satellite above the Earth, like G.I. Joe.
It wouldn't surprise G.I. Joe,
Oh, look, it's always good to get back to G.I. Joe. Let's
think of the G.I. Joe mission, the most recent movie where they have a satellite shooting a titanium or tungsten rod from space. That's the only thing I can think of where the missile is coming from satellite.
I was about to say, it's going to be satellite control because during that mission where you put the EMP on the tower, that tower is receiving a signal from a satellite. and you're knocking out the tower temporarily. So it wouldn't surprise me at all if our last mission would be to destroy that satellite, either put on a collision course with another satellite or do something to send it out into space or crash into the ocean, one or the other. But satellite, I think, would be the key. Once the satellites are down, then those drone swarms are basically useless.
Unless they go autonomous.
Yeah, I but wish still.
You could use those drone swarms. Yeah, I wish they could, were utilized. That could be breakpoint three. But they don't do anything, do they?
They just keep you on the island.
Death swarms?
Yeah, utilize within the game more.
I mean, from what I've heard,
the powers that launch them.
Yeah, from what I've heard is if you haven't died in a while and you are near one, then they do spawn out. But and it's to me, what I'm thinking is they're just basically replacing the drones that you may have killed already.
Well, if you read
if you're asking for them to be used during missions and stuff like that against you, how are you going to stop them? They're an instant kill, an infinite swarm. Yeah. You are not going to survive it. You can kill maybe a few, but that's a horde. You will not win that dodge.
I remember seeing somewhere in game. I remember seeing somewhere in game where it talked about the swarms are still active and being launched because there are still people trying to smuggle things on and off the island, and people trying to get on and off the island, and those swarms basically take care of the little one-offs here and there. That's why they keep them launched.
Actually, hold on. To have a statement against that, if we've defeated Walker and we've, in terms of the game, our character and our games, we've killed every Sentinel base, who's making these drones?
There's something in the lore that came out with episode 3 after we killed Stone, and they were referring to another CEO called the General. They didn't give a name, they didn't give an actual rank, they just said in quotations, the General.
Well, isn't the General the militia? I thought that was
the guy that you videoed.
the guy on the call with with the former MI6 guy. Wasn't his name in the dialogue the General?
Yeah, because he didn't die. He definitely didn't die.
Well, here's the question. I hope Ubisoft doesn't do this. What if they just write him off? Oh yeah, Team Rainbow tracked the call and captured him between these things. They'll probably do that because they've already wasted every other villain they had.
Well, again, we're all still, at this point in time, we're thinking about a broader spectrum of the island, whereas Slayer here mentioned, it could easily become not our fucking problem anymore. Bowman gets onto the island, I don't know fucking how, sits there and says, you're being tasked. And that's it. This place is no longer our fucking option.
She may not even set foot on the island. She may pull up in a boat and says, you've been repurposed. Come with me. Is your orders.
And then you're like, how did you get here?
Jeremy, I think you're right on that video that I made up. I mean, I could be completely wrong here, but I kind of see Bowman coming in a bit like where they utilized in Operation Oracle on Wildlands to use that to finish Wildlands, finish the story of Wildlands and move on to Breakpoint. I think Bowman's story is going to be to set up, because if this is coming out at the end of this year, I do believe that if they're making another game, it's a possibility that we'll get it at the end of next year. And they have said openly that what this event in fall is going to be about replayability. That was their own words. So don't expect missions. It's going to be something else. It's going to be a new mode or something. That's right. What they've said. It's going to be something that you can replay over and over to keep you going until the new game. And I believe that's why Bowman is being brought in to set up the next game, which does make you think of Wildlands 2. Now, we could do a whole other podcast about what we want from the next game, and I think we'll do that. But I definitely think that Wildlands 2 makes total sense. Because, first of all, if this game has been somewhat of a failure, Wildlands was not a failure, and it's best to use that name to go into your next game because of how successful Wildlands was. And I think that makes sense for them to do Wildlands 2 as opposed to a completely new named Ghost Recon game. I don't think that.
It would be really clever if they made the next Ghost Recon. Like, all of this is just set up. We have had no real clear direction on where to go no actual, like, somebody with field grade experience on organizing, you know, how to take back objectives, how to retake island or something like that, and get objectives done. Bowman, as a CIA handler, shows up to help get ready to clear all this shit out so that way we can all get out easily, because we still got fucking ghosts here on the island. If Nomad's the only one getting any fucking task, then what happens to the rest of them? You know, are they left to fend for them fucking selves or whatever?
Yeah, that, I think it'd be clever. That me and Adep talked about. There's still ghosts, counting all of them in the wild.
I think it'd be really clever if Operation Motherland wasn't just the name of this next update, but if that was the name for the next game, and it took place in wherever Operation Motherland was supposed to happen.
Oh, that's so an interesting idea.
I think that'd be really fucking clever.
With Recon Motherland.
What about that whole bit at the end of Wildlands where Bowman talks about looking through a crystal ball? And the fact that the that there's this whole other cartel, and that they're 10 times bigger than they were before. There's 10 times the amount of bad guys as there were before, and all that. But why did they put that? It just makes me, when you watch that again, and if you haven't seen it, anyone who's listening, like, go and watch it. Go and do that last mission. Watch that whole sequence again. Or it's, I put it on one of our videos recently. Why would they add that? Like, why would they bother? Really, it doesn't fit into that ending at all. Why would they?
I agree. I think the original intention,
to me, it is the intention was always to go back, and otherwise they would have just made the canon ending, and they would have never have done two endings. They'd have just done you kill him, end of done, and there was no need.
Blah, blah, blah.
Well,
for a crystal ball, but they didn't do that. They didn't do that, and they must have done it for a reason.
The cynic in me doesn't think that it might. I don't know. I want to believe that it's going to have something to do with it. If we're going to go after another cartel, going after Swania was kind of fun. But they've already shown that they're willing to ditch stories in order to scramble to come up with a new idea that can keep people going. If it happens, great. But I don't know if it's going to happen. Just because, again, we've had the transhumanism. I don't know what the hell they fucking... I don't remember what the hell they used to call it.
Transcendence.
You put Deus, your brain... Operation Deus. Computer. Operation Deus. The Deus Project, wherever the fucking hell it was. They dropped that. They dropped MOA. They dropped Wonderland. We don't have anything on any of those anymore. So... again, I want to be hopeful and optimistic, but the cynic inside me sits there and goes, maybe they probably ditched that too.
I think MOA was dropped because it was a raid island. I think MOA was the second raid island.
Yep.
And as soon as
they got the feedback
on the gear score, they were like, no one wants a raid island. Because don't forget, they only opened Golem Island to give people something extra to do. They'd already binned MOA at that point. So they were never going to go and create all those assets for somewhere for you to just run around on, because it would have taken a huge team. It's a big island. They scrapped that.
They're reusing what they already had.
And then concentrated on adding all those things into the game to make the game more like Wildlands was.
Yeah, and the game was in better shape at that point too. So that's why I don't think we're not going to see any new expansion outside of the mainland. I'm certain of it. They're just going to reuse the assets that are there. Everything is so sparsely spaced on the island that you got plenty of places that you can do things with that already have structures and forests and rocks and stuff that they don't have to hire somebody to sit there and add all those assets in.
Yeah, but so, give me some more underground stuff too, then. Yeah, give me some underground bases. I mean, true enough, there's probably two or three bases on the entire game that has underground capability. Yep. Outside, and then you got the one building with the Terminator. That was way underground. So where are all these other bases that are possibly underground? I mean, you got a mountain range.
Again, you got to hire somebody to design those. So I'm saying reuse the existing assets without adding anything to it is what I think is what's going to happen.
What about a Division 2 style system, Andy? In terms of you have to you set something up where you have a specific level and you have to take control of certain things and hold them, and then they can take
capture the
back.
Flag, which is what I've been wanting.
Yeah, all over the island. And once you do it all, you finally free a rower, and that's when you get your ending.
Yeah, but at least have some retaliation at the same time. You know, if you wait too long to try to capture some of these bases, you know, let's say it's just 10 bases.
Yeah, they get
taken back. So if it's only 10 bases you got to capture, but you got to do this in a 24-hour game period. You know, if you take too long, one of those bases is going to be recaptured.
Yeah, Andy and I
Now you're starting to dive into the topic of how long is too long. How long is not enough time?
I'm just using
that as an example.
In the division, you don't have to. I must admit, I played the Division 2 quite a lot for about 6 months, and how I believe it worked in that was that you take some of these bases, and I don't think it was you would turn the game on next time and you'd lost a load of them. I don't believe that was the way, but I think if you didn't turn the game on for quite a significant period of time, then you would have.
The game worked as if it was an actual lobby. Like, there were individual servers that you could go into, and you could see patrols and attacking units move from one base or from one checkpoint that was taken by whatever faction, and you would see their route to your checkpoint, and they could take it back. There was a chance that the people themselves would fight it off if they had enough supplies.
Yeah, and you could intervene in the middle of the attack, couldn't you, and stop it.
Well, you could even stop them on the way. So if you intercepted that team while they're on their route to get to that base, and wipe them out, that attack was no longer going to happen.
And it would take some time for reinforcements to come back. Even better.
But what was even better about it is the other factions in that game, not saying have other factions, hopefully not. But they would actually go and assault the other factions' bases as well. It wasn't just them on you, it was them versus each other versus you.
Does anyone think that we will get any actual new missions?
I'm hoping at least if they're gonna do a in-game type, give us at least 10, 15 missions and then one big boss kill at the end. But at the same time, like Wildlands, you had to go kill the under guys to get to the big guy.
I want a proper end to this story. But the players who have actually tried to keep track of everything and paid attention, for example, like me and a lot of other people, the reason we pay attention is because we care. The things that we enjoy, we really liked. I frankly liked working with Sam Fisher. I know a lot of people hated Episode 2 for how it represented the coolness factor that should have been there about Fisher, which I frankly don't get, but that's just me. I liked having Fisher. I liked having a more stealthy episode, which is what Splinter Cell is based on. It's a stealth game. I liked Episode 3 about get after it. You're getting cheap. Getting it done. You gotta go kill these people. I think Episode 1 was really good because obviously John Bernthal killed it as well. I want to see all of these parts of these episodes that have left unresolved be wrapped up. Do I agree with Random at this point? Sadly, yes. I'm not a cynical person, but I've stated examples that, granted, he didn't give, but fit to what he said. They've probably thrown these plot points away, or he might have said them. I just might not have heard them. They threw away all their main villains so far, and story needs a MacGuffin. And when it's a story like Breakpoint, a villain, in my opinion, fits that MacGuffin extremely well. And now they don't have a MacGuffin, and people are getting bored. There's no one to really look at and be like, oh, I'm going to go take this guy, fucking rip him apart, you know. But you look at Walker, you look at the strategist, you look at Bukhara. These are villains that you're like, I'm going to go kill you, bitch. You know?
I'm sorry, I missed that. Can you repeat the whole thing?
All I heard was kiss ass, and kiss ass.
So basically what I'm saying is I hope that Random is wrong, well, come to terms where if he's right that we probably won't get a proper end off to the plot points that are left.
I think we're more likely to get a story that builds to a new game than we are a proper ending to this game.
You can do both at the same time. Absolutely. If you do it right.
100%.
If you do it right, you like you said, you know, Operation Motherland could be the next game's name.
That's what I'm hoping, is if they do it right, this is no longer about, hey, you're getting retasked, you're off the island. It's about, hey, you're stuck. I'm here to help give you some direction. We got some intel. Let's fucking get this shit done. Then we got to go. Get your team ready.
Here's a possibility, you know, just using hypotheticals on this. Operation Motherland. Where's Motherland from Nomad? U.S. continent.
I doubt we're going to the USA. I really do.
Yeah, but I'm just using it as a hypothetical. Nope. I mean, Call of Duty has done it.
You know, even the Division does it.
I mean, Call of Duty has done it. They've had attacks on the U.S. soil.
I hope.
I think it should be a massive, this game is very sneaky beaky. Too tactical sometimes. I like to go loud. I like to shoot the fucking shit out of people.
Yep.
Nice
yep.
people, yeah, gunfights, and all that sort of shit.
You only like to shoot nice people.
Proper. What?
No. Nice people.
There's always going to be civilian casualties no matter what.
Whoa. Right?
So this game should, at some point, you should be able to have a massive fuck off battle where you and your AI teammates, you can direct them to do counter attacks, section attacks, flanking, all that sort of stuff, like ambushes, proper ambushes, and just fucking take on the enemy, proper head on, proper loads of ammo, getting down. You know, none of this sneaky beaky.
That's not Ghost Recon's job, though.
Yeah,
you know, I get what you're saying. And I know Ghost Recon's a little bit sneaky beaky, but maybe things up a bit.
Ghost Recon, oh man, this is where I wish they would remaster the old games, because then that would fucking help clarify this a lot. Thank you. In the old Ghost Recon, it was all about strategy. You had the enemy and objectives to get to. You didn't have to kill everybody in order to complete your objective, but you did not have a suppressor. Certain specialists did, but you did not. Your bare basic guys that you picked up to go and rock did not have suppressors. They had handguns with suppressors, but that shit didn't. It was a handgun with a suppressor. Low range, low damage. You had to be good.
Yeah.
And it wasn't enforced. It was definitely not a game about, you know, getting in, getting out unseen. It was about getting in, doing your job, and then leaving. And that meant setting your guys up, getting your strategy set up, making a plan. And then after that, controlling chaos. You opened up. The enemy had to rush around to try to get into position. You could set up one set team. You had two teams, three-man teams. You could set one up on one side. You can set one up on the other side. You can tell them both suppressive fire as soon as you took a shot. Or you can tell them just, you know, hey, shoot when I shoot. You could have them recon. You could set them to move around. They'd actually do recon. They'd mark enemy positions. But the second you went loud, they went loud. And it went all over. So you could set up your ambushes. You could set up your main attacks. You could set up your plans. You could set up your flanks. None of that was ever about, I'm going to go in, kill every single person, and nobody's going to know I was there. Because I was sitting there with a silenced pistol or a silenced goddamn fucking sniper rifle that these motherfuckers can't hear from 50 goddamn meters. I'm going to take attack 50. Well, they didn't hear that.
The sneaky stuff is...
Yeah, that is...
relatively new concept. Everybody keeps saying that, that's what the ghost means in Ghost Recon. That is not what it means. It's the ghost of Ghost Recon.
They were surgical.
Yep.
Yeah. The old SAS. If the SAS were first introduced, it was behind the enemy lines, caused absolute fucking chaos. and then get out.
Yep, and you're unacknowledged.
Behind enemy lines, create absolute chaos, let the enemy go, what the fuck is going on? And then they're gone. Disappeared.
But the SEAL teams were before everybody started using them as a commercial thing.
I found that even between this game and the last game, that the way that the game is played primarily has changed a little bit. And even though they are very similar in the way that they play, if you've watched Wildlands videos when the game first came out, there was not a lot around about no HUD stealth on Wildlands. Nope.
It was all there card really cases. Was not. Yeah, it was card cases and coordinated takedowns.
Yeah, it did come in and people did play it like that. And in all fairness, people should be able to play the game however they like. And I've got no issues with that. I like doing stealth stuff, but it wasn't made necessarily for that. I mean, I quite like the fact on Wildlands, it was supposed to give you the choice. You know, you could have your entire team parachute out of a helicopter, land right in the middle of a compound and get into a massive firefight, get your objective done, go. Or you could try and sneak in, kill people silently, get out again, whatever. That's the whole point of it. Whereas I think in Breakpoint, it seems to have been very much pushed in this stealthy kind of...
Yeah, I think some of that is from targeting an audience too.
Yeah, there's definitely a different kind of objective there in the way that they set this game up. Now, primarily, the best thing they could do going forward is to make sure that both of those kind of core groups of players are covered. So you can play the game loud and crazy, and you can also play it silent, sneaky. There's nothing wrong because it's fun doing both. Go on, dude.
I think they should limit that, though, because, I mean, you're going to step on your own toes. Splinter Cell is all about the stealth. So, you know, you can do some stealth in Ghost Recon, but I don't think it should be a primary goal because that kind of negates the reason. Perhaps that's one of the reasons we haven't had a new Splinter Cell game in a while because they figure that genre is covered with Ghost Recon. I think a lot of the changes that you're talking about, Andy, I think they came about because they changed their target audience.
Yeah, I agree.
I think I honest to God think that they need to go back and look at what the Ghost Recon was as a core. This game is no longer about being surgical and precise. Wildlands was about making as much noise as humanly possible in certain areas, being absolutely quiet as the grave and other areas, and taking out targets along a ladder. Swiping out the feet underneath the drug lord and then taking out the drug lord himself. In this one, it's about, they was originally said, you're surviving and trying to get yourself to be combat effective once again. No longer is it like that. It's go here, do all these odd jobs, and then fucking stop a major attack on U.S. soil, which they fucking did. Well, not just U.S. soil. I'm pretty sure it was around the world. Which they did time and time again. But it's not surgical anymore. It's not key, not focused. Back in the other, in the old games, even in Future Soldier, you had a very focused mindset on how the game was being done and how your mission was being tackled. Now, you can have all of your different strategies going in stealth and whatnot, and all those apply, even in the old Ghost Recons. You had a POW camp that you had to go into. Obviously, you don't want to go in loud and fucking proud. They could execute the prisoners. So you bring your specialists with your fucking suppressed weaponry. But it was still very surgical. Get in. Don't bother about everybody else. Get in. Find the objective. Get the fuck out. And it's not like that anymore. Everybody worries about... That's
pretty much what the mission is anyway. I
completely agree.
Well, not anymore.
Yeah,
is all about taking out an entire base instead of just getting in, doing an objective, and getting out.
Yeah, I mean, that's what it should be. I mean, even if you have a full, mission-based setup, I mean, creators, the dailies, you know, mission creators, you can easily set that up yourself.
Yeah. And I think that's part of the replayability that Andy was referring to.
Right. But if you got to go off of the storyline, yeah, you got to clear the entire base before you can move on.
No, I don't think that's true. I don't think that's true at all.
I mean, if it's a snatch and grab, you can find out where the person is, go get them, boom, you're out of there. You haven't even had to shoot one shot. But if you got to go in there and kill a drone,
yeah,
you're going to make some noise.
No, see, I deal with these spectrum missions daily. We do these every day, and I got to tell you that if we go in there and we know that we have to hack a computer or override an antenna, you clear the base before you do that. Because you're going to get 2 minutes worth of reinforcements coming in. And if you don't clear the base, you're going to have guys shooting you in the back while you're trying to deal with that as well.
Mm-hmm. Now, like the ones in Wildlands, Fallen Ghosts, where you had to hold a tower. That was, 3 to 5 minutes? That was a battle.
Yeah, but you were attracting that attention. That was the goal. But also in Wildlands, where you had one of the major Uni databases.
Amazing Fallen Ghosts.
Yeah, it was. But in a Uni database, you had a computer to hack into.
Yeah.
In a Uni database, you had a computer to hack into. You could get into that place without any issue by only eliminating one entrance. And that entrance could also be your exit. You could take another thing. You didn't have to wipe out the three major entrances or technically four, and the bases they were connected to. That was a fucking shit ton of ground.
Yeah. And then I like the idea, okay, if you did get spotted and then you got the chevrons as far as your enemy activity is an alertness. You know, okay, like if you get one chevron, it's only the base. But now if you start getting up to 2, 3, and 4, now you got battalions coming after you.
Yeah. I find Ghost Recon Breakpoint is too surgical, too clinical, it's too clean. There's not enough going on. It's too, you know, you can wander around for fucking ages without stumbling into somebody. With Wildlands, you've got all the locals, the vehicles moving around. You're flying up in a helicopter and you can see vehicles with like the headlights for nighttime.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I don't know.
Is dead.
And Lee, I think you've just given us, I think, what will be our discussion for podcast episode 2. So I think we should do on the next one. I think we should talk about what we want in the next game. And so we can utilize things from Breakpoint and from Wildlands and the type of game that we want and discuss what we want in a new game. I think we'll make that the next episode, 100%.
Yeah, I agree.
I think we hit the nail on the head
with that. You got to have high stakes if it's going to be immersive.
100%. Does anyone have any final thoughts before we...
I've joined Tyrant. He's convinced me I want an M16 too. I'll join him.
That's the prize.
Just as a final, the Nomad in Breakpoint has no sense of humor whatsoever compared to the Nomad from Wildlands.
My guess is that's their extremely lazy way of showing how Weaver's death affected him. Which is not nearly enough, in my opinion.
That's dog turd. He slides down a hill like he's got King Kong's finger up his bum, and that's it. He makes a funny noise, and that is it. We don't get no shit balls, or fuck this, or fuck that, or there's no swearing. It's just shit balls.
Well, the only time he said
on the way down a hill, I want to hear him say that down a hill, just shit, boss, shit, boss, shit, boss.
Yeah, I mean, the only other time you hear him say anything is when a Azrael drone comes up and says, what the fuck is that?
Very low. It's all just grunting. It's like autistic Batman, just all grunting.
another thing, they treat Nomad like he's dumb as hell and weak as a child.
Indeed.
Especially with those camera angles. Whenever you go into cutscenes, it looks like he's just... Ugh.
I'm just tired of him being uncoordinated and
Kong's finger.
Not very representative of special forces, in my opinion.
No,
uncoordinated.
So, that's why I think that their military advisor was someone who probably in the Air Force and just didn't do much.
He was in
combat.
That is a shiny ass.
That's a right one, Valor too.
Yeah, I'm talking about the designed. The combat aspect of the game.
Yeah.
They probably didn't fucking listen to him regardless anyway. Oh. The dude said he was right.
That's the thing is that we have no idea what he was used for. They could have sat him down.
They said he was a right.
Can you tell us this, 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 and this? And he gave them all the information and detail that they needed.
And they didn't.
Well, it's not so much they didn't listen to him, but it might be the things that have absolutely nothing to do. I mean, look at the weapons, for example, about how the weapons are calibrated wrongly. Tyrant, Slayer, and I have obviously discussed this, Jeremy and I, in great length recently on a video. But they may not have asked him about any of that stuff. They might have been more concerned about how he moved in combat or how he did this or what he was wearing. Or it could have been real basic stuff. He probably gave them all that he... Let's face it, he obviously knows what he's doing. But... They might have gone, well, you know, don't need that.
As a writer,
they should have got Dale Dyer and Andy McNabb to do this game.
Well, you know Dale that whoever they got is not recognizable. Otherwise, they'd be wearing his name on their sleeve everywhere. They would be using that marketing everywhere.
I'm not sure I'd want Dale Dyer doing this game.
Dale Dyer,
Andy McNabb, surely.
My big closing thought for this episode, Andy, aside from the Boss G12, Dart Thunder, and the grenade launchers, give us suppressors on every single fucking weapon system in the game. Do it.
Not gonna happen.
Oh, really?
Yeah, indeed.
That's a new idea.
Boss
I hadn't heard that one before.
Boss G12, Sharp Thunder, grenade launcher. Otherwise, I think they should be able to be suppressed. That's all I have to say.
Nope. That's totally not been said to Ubisoft at all, ever, in any of the Reddits or any of the fucking videos.
This is news to me. I've never heard this before.
Oh, wow, this is the first time I've ever heard of it.
Ghillie hoods functioning.
Oh, my sweet Jesus fucking Christ.
Oh, ghillie hoods too? Holy shit.
Damn, man. We're fucking going into some uncharted territory. Holy shit.
Sounds like episode 2.
Anyway, that's what we're going to do on episode 2. We're going to talk about what we want from the next game. So if you want to leave a comment down below on things that you'd like to see utilized in the next game, we will go through the comments and we will include those and discuss those. But if anyone's got any final thoughts on year 2 or any of the content, if not, then we'll wrap up. But anyone got any final thoughts?
Nope.
I'm fine, you're not allowed.
Nothing legal.
Nothing legal.
G.I. Joe.
Well.
G.I. Joe, definitely. I completely agree.
I've already decided episode 3 is going to be crossovers. Crossovers that will actually work. We are going to discuss crossovers on...
G.I. Joe.
We're going to talk about G.I. Joe for 2 hours.
If Nomad does not ever fucking scream, "Yo, Joe," I'm going to be fucking pissed.
That's like that emotion.
Yo, Joe!
Come on, Joe, do it.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, this has been a Bullet Catcher Gaming Podcast. Join us the next time for another exciting episode. Just watch and join us. The Discord info will be in the description, and plus, join. It's very active. Comment, like, and subscribe as you wish. But don't worry. We're not worried about your real comments. We just want to know your comments about the show today. Leave some comments down in the bottom for any future episodes that you'd like to hear us talk about, as well as more of year 2 comments. This has been a Bullet Catcher Gaming Podcast. We're signing off.